أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today we are going to be talking about the first type of nafs, inshallah ta'ala. And this is called the nafs al-amara. Nafs al-amara. And really this means the nafs that urges the individual to sin, to do evil. Now, this nafs al-amara is actually mentioned in the Quran in Surah Yusuf, which is Surah number 12, verse 53. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed, the nafs that overwhelmingly commands a person to do sin. Of course, there are different translations to this. So please, as I always say to you, my brothers and sisters, go and look at the different translation as if you're not an Arabic speaker, because it will mean that you get a more wide knowledge of what the Arabic actually means. So, inna nafsal amaratun bisu'i. Indeed, the soul, this type of nafs, is a definite enjoined of evil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing something here. And it's something that he does in other places in the Quran as well. He is saying, indeed, the soul is definitely inherently evil. We are inherently evil. Subhanallah, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. That the nafs commands a person to do sin, okay? Now, actually, this message comes through the voice of the wife of Al-Aziz, okay? The wife of Al-Aziz, of course, because we have a lesson to learn from her. We're going to talk about that lesson a little bit later on. Maybe not even in this lecture, maybe in a later one. But when we look at the nafs al-amara, this refers to when our nafs, our soul, is in that state that actually there's no hope for this nafs, because we have succumbed to evil. We have succumbed to sin. And you know, some people, they really don't care if they're sinning or not. They really don't care if they're going against something that really your heart is usually constantly telling you is not the right way to go. I'm not here just talking about people from a Muslim background, maybe people from a Christian background or any other background that maybe they're doing something, say, that's immoral as opposed to sinful. If you're not from a religious background, then, you know, there's also morals and values, moral codes that you follow. So, for example, stealing from somebody. So, for example, hurting somebody, committing some kind of oppression on somebody. This is something that, for regardless of what faith somebody is, and in particular my brothers and sisters, because as Muslims we have guidance on this, that we know this is inherently wrong. So the nafs al-amara is the nafs, it just carries on and does what it feels. It doesn't really care about the consequences. It doesn't think about anything like that. It's just going ahead. It gets this gut reaction, you're going to do this, it doesn't matter about anybody else, it doesn't matter about the consequences, I'm just going to do whatever I like, I'm free. The attitude is, I'm free to do what I like, and as long as I get away with it, it's okay, it's all right. So this type of nafs, it rules like a king over the self. It means this nafs commands us, it commands us and tells us what to do, and we submit to that nafs. So instead of submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're submitting to our own desires, to our own urges, if you like. So when this nafs has any wish, any appetite for something, it just says, right, go and have that. And it dominates us. So we said, okay, no problem. Because that looks fun, right? So it dictates and it commands. Now, going back to the context of this particular verse in Surah 12, verse 53. Actually, the wife of Al-Aziz has attempted previously to seduce Yusuf alayhi salam, the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. And at this point in the journey of Yusuf alayhi salam, she admits the truth that it was her and not Yusuf who was at fault. So she admits that actually it was the nafs al-amara that she was submitting to, that it was inherently evil. And in this case, of course, it was lust. You know, Yusuf alayhi salam is known to be the most handsome human being, subhanAllah. So he's in the sejan, he's in the prison, but he's in prison as an innocent man. But at this point in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to us about the story that when she admits, and even though he's already there as a trusted person in the prison, she admits openly now at this stage that she was in the wrong. And then the king releases Yusuf alayhi salam and appoints him as a very high up political figure. In fact, he's in charge of the most important thing in the country, which is the grain stores. He's in charge of the food supplies. I guess the modern version is you would be in charge of the governmental food supplies, or the one of the biggest companies in the country that supplies food to all the general public. So this is a position that only an extremely trusted person can have. Now let's go back to the verse, Surah 12, verse 53, and through these three lectures, especially the first two, we're going to keep on returning to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in these particular verses, or in this one verse particular, Surah 12, verse 53, Surah Yusuf. Because what we've seen already is that inna nafsu amaratun bisu'i, indeed the soul is definitely enjoined of evil. So has the hope gone at this stage, my brothers and sisters? When we commit sin, does that mean that that's it? You know, we've submitted to our nafs. Do you have that type of nafs? Is there any hope? Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throw us a rope of hope? Tune in for the next lecture, inshallah ta'ala, lecture number two, which will be talking about the next type of nafs. Stay with me. Jazakum Allah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.